Whatever. I don't need to be in charge of everything.
I know.
That was just.
Yeah, yeah, because you start out the middle and you could go quickly.
Hey, good morning.
Yeah.
This isn't part of the show. This is just my presence someone gave me. Make sure nobody takes it.
Can you get your email? Or send me your email, text it to me.
Please send me a glass of water.
Okay, how am I doing?
See, just go to the counter.
Sure.
They've got.
Okay.
When we're done here, that table that we've seen over here.
Yes.
Thank you, Jennifer, for being here.
Oh, yes.
How are you today? It's like, I think everything is now in that sort of my mind.
Yeah.
That's how I operate.
And then it all comes to you.
Yes, but it's always fine after this. If you don't know what it's like,
it's that.
Right.
It's kind of
oh.
Well,
I mean, okay. Oh, that's fine.
That's good. Great job.
Thank you very much. They're in North Carolina, and their home field mic wasn't working.
Yeah.
I had 4 hours.
Well, they run me out of town on the road, Gary.
Yeah. So far, you're good. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Sorry about the microphone.
Oh, no, that's fine.
I just want to be sure the camera picked it up, and Frank will say he thinks so.
We'll find out.
Yeah, there it is.
We'll find out. Yeah.
Sorry about that.
No. The
microphone died out.
Is anybody showing up? In?
I don't know.
I'll find out shortly.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
I don't know what that one is.
Some days I miss his chips.
It'll be on YouTube. You can see it online.
Well, that's the thing. Now that we like to say, now that we like built to officially have people be a team, he's going to show up and look like the trash and just sit there and watch it happen. I'm like, oh, so I can get back and wear my costume. There's me crazy lady on the side. I like how you did that. Yeah. That's my musical trace. I have crank hands. That's my crank hands.
Down the master volume a little bit.
This is good.
Turn it down, because it's bleeding in the other room. Turn it down. Right? Check. A little bit more. Check.
It's amazing how Frank can get everyone's attention.
I start, so y'all gotta tell me when to start.
Oh, really? That's a
really
perfect.
She started
herself. Yes. Can you bring in all our tears to her? Who's bringing your labor to here? You don't know. Stacy should be out
there. Right here.
This gentleman, as you know, you have a flag in my car.
Hello. Hi. It's testing. We're just testing.
We're done.
There's 2.5 hours left.
Okay. Are we ready? We good? Okay, so my name is Scrappy. I am from the Early Riser Baseball Club of Detroit. I have been involved in vintage baseball for 13 years now, and I started off as what we call crank, and I wanted to get involved, but at the time I couldn't afford the costumes, I couldn't do this, you know, it's expensive. So I devised a way of how to make my own stuff to look the part, and it's it turns out to get people involved to come to the games and to participate in the games, they want to be involved and dress up too, but they're very afraid of how do I do that? How much does it cost? What do I have to do? So today's, well, my presentation is to tell you how to look the part, but how to do it in a way that anybody can do. You don't have to be a vintage police to do this. So I have Jennifer here. She's from the
Dayton History.
I'm going to start with her. She is wearing women's dress. Now, this is not about just women, but you got women doing it, so. She is here to show exactly what a spectator should look like, okay? Because we're playing in the 1860s. She brought a bunch of accessories, so I'm going to let her start, go over exactly what she's wearing, what they would have worn, go over her accessories and everything, and then I'll tell you how to do this in an achievable way. So I will give it off to you, Jennifer. Here you go.
Okay, all right, thank you. And for the men, I can give you, I have to look it up though, but there is a blogger who does, who also talks about men's fashion, has like a little fashion kit for that she suggests to men for 1860s on what to wear. So I just have to look at my phone to catch that, but I'll do that afterwards. But yes, I am Jennifer. I work at Dayton History, and mostly at our Carillon Historical Park site. And that, I understand, is where you all are going this afternoon. So yes, that is where I work. That is one of our sites. We do living history there. So we do have some costume people. Okay. All right. So is that better? Okay.
Frank, is that better?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Direct approach.
So anyways, we do living history. We do the era of the 1860s at one of our sites. And so basically I'm here to talk to you about what you'd be wearing and the different layers and starting from the inside out. And so we're going to get a little bit personal here with some stuff. But because I'm going to be focusing on the ladies. And I'm going to start first with the undergarments. So we're going to start with the chemise. So the chemise is like your undershirt, which is going to protect your outer clothing. You would have multiples of these that you would wear, change out every day under your outer garments. And they are made of cotton, and it makes for easy washing. It holds up to the harsh washing practices of the day with the lye soap and the scrubbing and the washing boards. But this is what is going to, you wear this because this is what is going to catch all your oil and sweat that you have from your body. So it's going to help protect. So that is the chemise. And then we move on to our drawers.
Now grab one side.
Yes. So actually, when these are together, they actually are very modest and very comfortable to wear. But there is a reason why they are split down in the middle. And that is because once you have all your layers and you kind of get locked into place with the corset, it's very difficult to use the restroom like we would normally do. So in this way, you just separate the drawers, you do your thing, and then you let it fall back into place and go on about your business. So these are also made of cotton or linen, just like the chemise. Again, because it holds up to the harsh the washing practices of the day. And so you would also have multiples of these that you would be wearing. And these can also be just like your chemise. You can embroider them as well. Women do that, kind of, this is embroidered. I don't know we do have some embroidered chemises, but. All right, so. This is the corset, which usually gets a lot of groans, but I have, you know, there's mostly men in here. But usually if there's a group of ladies, we get a lot of groans and it kind of gets a bad rap. Because actually it's, I'm gonna argue for it because it's actually very comfortable, but I'll explain why it gets a bad rap. But first and foremost, this is your bust support of the day. And it's also going to lock things in place. It's also going to help kind of relieve any weight that's on your hips, sort of like distribute that weight a little bit easier so you don't have it digging into your hips. That's basically what the corset's main function is. Now, why it gets a bad rap is because of something called tight lacing. So think of Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind and holding onto the bedpost, right, being squeezed real tight. So, and you have women that, you know, you hear about women that can't breathe, they're fainting or whatever, so it's very constrictive. Well, tight lacing was something that was high fashion. So it was sort of like, we can compare it to women today wearing pumps with like, you know, heels that are like, you know, that high. So yes, there's some women that do that, but most of us don't. Okay, so for most women, the corset was just a gentle hug around you. That's what it felt like. And it helps to also achieve that shape that you want. So it's like the shapewear of the day, where you want the smaller looking waist in there, but you don't have to, you know, tight lace to get that. Also, you might hear women complain that it's uncomfortable, and it's probably because they bought one from somewhere and didn't have it made to fit them. So with corsets, for it to be comfortable, because otherwise it's like wearing the wrong size shoe, it's not gonna be comfortable, so you have to have it made to your body for it to be comfortable. Because like when I started out doing this, I had someone give me their corset. I'm rather short waisted, and so this was her corset was trying to stretch me in ways that I can't stretch. And so it was very uncomfortable. But you know, getting into a corset that fit me, very comfortable. So in fact, most of the ladies that I work with say that they would prefer to wear a corset underneath their clothes, underneath their modern day clothes if they could, because they find it very comfortable. And a nice back support too for it.
What's that made at that level?
So bone, it can be made out of bone. I'm not sure of like what else, because I have to say that this isn't really my area, like my strong area.
The material is
made out of linen.
Can I answer the question? It's made out of a fabric called coutil. And coutil is double woven. It's woven in often a chevron pattern to give it additional stability. And then boning comes, you get three different kinds of boning. You either have plastic, you have sprung steel, or you have wrapped steel. And so if you're using plastic, that's got the most flexibility, but it's also the weakest, and it tends to break fairly easily. If you're using flat steel, that's very rigid, and it's usually only used in the front and the back, especially in the older air corsets where you need a lot of rigidity right there. And
why
then,
didn't you up here with us? I didn't know you knew all this.
Oh, I was a costume designer for 16 years.
Well, good that you were here, because I don't know getting into a lot of specifics. I mean, I have some resources that I can give, but it's not my strong area. But I can say that, you know, some of the basics about it. So this is going on this is your cage. So this is what is going to give you your nice bell shape. And this is from, just hold it up. So this would be the front right here, the back up here. So this is going to give you a nice bell shape that you're trying to achieve during this time underneath. And these were great when they came out because prior to this, you were wearing layers of petticoats underneath. So, which we'll get to the petticoats in just a second. But the petticoats, and if I don't know if anybody has done any other interpreting of any other eras that use the petticoats, but they are a lot of fabric because you're using like 5, 6, 7 layers of petticoats to achieve that shape. And you can barely walk, the material is getting all wrapped up in your legs, you can't do long strides, very difficult to run, I found out playing with a bunch of kids in my 1830s costume, because we also do 1830s at Carolina Historical Park. So anyways, and this is from the early 60s, later 60s, you start to see an elliptical shape to it, and sort of pushing the fabric material, like everything back. So sort of kind of giving you the junk in the trunk kind of look. Kind of a transition to where we get to bustles later to like the 1870s, 1880s, which I always think of like the stepsisters and Cinderella or bustles. But anyways, so cages start to show up around the 1850s and they just allow for freedom of movement. And we see all levels of society wearing these. So that's a little bit about the cage. And there's lots of different patterns for them. So you'll see some that are covered with fabric and ones that are made out of different material. And then over that, you would then have your petticoat. And you would have, you know, one, maybe two, if you wanted to have a little extra oomph in your bell shape. But these are made of cotton as well that you know can be easily washed. They would be lightly starched to help kind of give it your skirt more volume on there and to help kind of hold the shape of it. You could also wear, if it's cold outside, underneath, ladies would wear a wool petticoat to help keep their legs warm. So we're going to move on to what you'd be wearing as far as your feet and stuff. So I have some silk stockings here. So these come up to the knee. You could also have cotton stockings. And in the winter time, ladies would knit wool stockings. So of course, just like us today, we want the thick, chunky socks during the winter months. So did they. As far as you know, having something warm, and then I have these come from a company, American Duchess. They do replica footwear, historically accurate replica footwear. They're rather expensive, I have to say. So some of my coworkers do have American Duchess replica shoes. I have to say that mine are. A little bit cheaper because I got mine on Amazon, so they're not as historically accurate as these. But anyways, these are shoes that are like a silk sateen with leather on them, and of course decorated with a buckle on there. There is a difference between your everyday boots that you're wearing during the day and then in the evening. If you're going out for the evening and you're wearing an evening dress or a ball gown, you'd be wearing slippers that would oftentimes be dyed to match the color of your dress. Then we're going to move to the dresses themselves. So I'm wearing a day dress and this is appropriate for everyday look for everyday woman who is, you know, cleaning, dusting, cooking, cleaning out the fireplace. So this is totally appropriate. They were oftentimes made of cotton. Cotton can be easily washed because these are gonna be getting, you know, dirty, a lot of wear and tear on it. So they were oftentimes made with darker fabric and with pattern on it to help hide any stains or any fading that might happen. You could have dresses too. They did have dresses made of wool. And you could actually wear the wool year round, because at this time they were making a semi-sheer wool fabric that you could use. Also, it might be surprising to hear that it wasn't uncommon for women to own a silk dress at this time. And that's because of the garment trading that was going on with silk. So you would get secondhand, thirdhand silk, and you could either take it and use it as your own dress, or make some alterations to it, or take the fabric and make a new dress out of it. And of course, this would be your best dress. Something with the day dresses that are kind of a giveaway that it is a day dress is that they have long sleeves on them that come down to the wrist and high necklines. You can also, with the day dress, you can have a variation with the sleeves. So you can kind of get fancy with them. You can have drapey sleeves with some under sleeves, so they're just sleeves that kind of roll up and stuff about here with these drapey sleeves. But those, you're not going to be cleaning your house in a dress like that. That's a little bit fancier. For a more practical look, you have, it's less fabric, narrower, sleeve. Mine, I have to say, is a little, it's not as fancy as some of the drapey ones, but it is kind of fancy because I do have some trim on here that's lace trim. Now, if you are going to have trim, you probably want to, women would have it, it'd be easier to have it of the same material that your dress is made out of for washing purposes, because when you get into things like lace, with the washing practices of the day, you would have to pick off all the lace if you're going to wash this, and then wash it, and then reattach the lace on afterwards. So that's a lot of work. So anyways, that's a little bit about the day dress. Evening dresses, which probably isn't really what you would be having in yours, but just to mention what you guys do, but just to mention evening dresses and ball gowns. They have a plunging neckline, and especially with the ball gowns, they are off the shoulder. They have shorter sleeves on them, and you have lots of embellishments on them. So you have fringe, you have beads, you have tassels on them. So you can, you have plenty of embellishments, because they did really like that at the time. Accessorizing is really big during this time, so you'll notice I'm wearing a lot of accessories. So I have on my hairnet here, which the main purpose of the hairnet was to keep the hair in place. And you'll notice that it's different from a 1940s snood in that it's more delicate. So think of like lunch ladies, hairnets. So that's the kind of type of material that you have. And then you can embellish it however you want to, like with ribbon. I have a ribbon and tassel here. So they're kind of fun. Here's another one that my coworker, most of the stuff belongs to her, and she's made most of it. But anyways, this is one that she made in here. And of course, I have, belts were very popular at the time as well, to kind of accentuate your waist. And they're not all matchy-matchy like we are today, so you don't have to really concern about being matchy-matchy. But anyway, so I have some more belts here if you want to look at later. And I have a bow tie on, which was kind of a common accessory. We also see brooches as well. So I have a couple of brooches here. Earrings, the drop style earrings are really popular at the time. And then, carry around your handkerchief, which I always do because I always seem to have a runny nose. So this one came from a Godey Fashion Ladies book. So what you can get, you can find the ladies, Godey's ladies books online. They're archived, and you can look them up online. So this particular one came of pattern from a pattern from that from the Godey's ladies book. And then gloves. So leather gloves are popular at this time. They come to hit the wrist, about wrist length there. And then sort of moving to your outer wear. So I have here two different bonnets. So, and there's different styles of bonnets and hats at this time. So this is one, and I love the pattern on this, and it is historical. This is a sun bonnet, slat bonnet. So this is going to protect you from the sun because it actually kind of hangs over your face. It's long, so it's protecting your neck as well. And then, you know, if you do have any shoulders exposed. So there's a sun bonnet. This is a fashion bonnet. And like I said, you can look up, I can suggest a book that mentions a couple of different fashion bonnets. But this one's a straw one, so you see straw a lot in the summer. And in the winter, it would be buckram, which is like a sturdy type of thick material that then you cover with silk. So you can wear that, and of course you can embellish these. And then shawls, and there is, this is an appropriate color because there's synthetic dyes that we start to see around this time. Especially like magenta is very popular. This was taken from a 1964 Godey's ladies book, the pattern of it. So there's a shawl there. Does anybody have any questions?
Can you talk a bit more about the Godey's book or that you've referred to? Would I be able to find that online if I wanted to?
Yes, you can find it online. And
how do you spell that?
It's Godey.
And if I can make another suggestion,
yes.
You also would want to look up the Delineator. That was another really popular ladies magazine at the time. And that will also have all kinds of patterns, and it'll have also all kinds of sort of social etiquette type of articles that tell you how to actually wear the clothing and in what environments.
Is that Delineator?
Delineator, yep.
Okay, sounds like a superhero.
Doesn't it though?
Okay, Delineator.
Yeah, so if you look up, you can find patterns in there and just fashion advice and stuff like that.
And also you talked about, and if I get this wrong, I apologize, darker dresses?
Right, the darker fabric.
Okay, like black, blue, red, what?
Blues, yeah, black. I mean, you could have, yeah, different colors, but just darker ones that hit, because it hits stains, and especially with patterns, it just hits stains better.
Okay, of course.
Oh, yes, I do have a pocket with him.
Pockets and dresses were not invented. So if you see that meme on Facebook that's like, oh, I got a new dress, it has pockets. There's a joke to that. This is why.
Yes. Like, so, yeah, so I have a pocket. Yeah.
That's a pocket. It would have, do you have the slit in the dress to get to it, or do you just?
No, I don't. But you, yeah, this one wasn't made with the slit in the dress to get to it. But, yeah, you would have your pockets on the inside.
Yeah. That's the coolest thing. I was like, you got to show them the pocket. Because people don't realize, like, where did you put your stuff? Yeah. You had the slit to get into your pocket. It was
Kind of like a pot, I mean, like a purse or something. Where did you put it?
That's different. Yeah, that's a whole other presentation talking about the handbag. So,
yeah.
A whole other story.
So, Yvette is giving her talk. I'll make sure I look up the blog for men's clothing. But this was given to me by my husband. It's okay. It's called a Victorian Lady's Guide to Fashion and Beauty by Mimi Matthews. So anyways, it goes through the different decades, which is just kind of interesting, of the Victorian era. So kind of interesting. And then you can always reach I'm a living history assistant, but our living history specialist, she has her master's in this, so she's very knowledgeable. I have her card here if you have any questions that you would like to ask her. She's at a wedding today, so that's why she can't be here. But anyways, I have her email address. So, all right,
cool. Okay, so the point of this is to show you what deters people from, what deters people from getting involved, being a sideline interpreter. When one of us shows up at a match, or you go to a museum and you see this, the first thing your spectators, which is generally your wives, your mothers, your kids, right? Because most of us are guys doing this. They look at that and they think, oh yeah, I ain't doing that. Nope, I'm not doing that. I'm not doing the bloomers, I'm not doing the things. Okay, so let's go over a couple things. And this now this goes for men and women now. But the major takeaway from this is what? The materials. What did she keep saying? Cotton. It's a very cheap, basic thing you can get at Joann's if you really want to try making this yourself. However, it's also very, very, very cheap at the thrift store as bed sheets. So, when I first started out, I would, I don't use these regularly. So when I first started out, I wanted to go from 0 to 60, right? I wanted the whole thing. I didn't even know how to sew myself then. I went to the thrift store and I knew linen, cotton. If I could find a bed sheet to practice on, I did. Or I went to the women's section. I found cotton slips. Went home, cut the elastic out, flipped the top over, put a drawstring in. Boom, I had a petticoat. That simple for $3. So we want to involve our spectators. Even our own players, even our own club members. We want to get more people involved. But what deters them? The price, the look. I can't do that, I can't do this. Most important thing, honestly, is to keep it simple. Right, remember that, keep it simple, stupid. That's it, if you have any notes today, write that down. Keep it simple, stupid. Honestly, you can do this, anyone can do this. I have a story, I'm gonna bring up one of the guys from one of our clubs. So exciting that he did this on their own. A couple guys, they went to the thrift store and they wanted to get outfits and accessories, like they wanted to do the look. And the one guy, he said, well, I wanted to wear the embroidered vest. I couldn't find the embroidered vest. And I said, good, because unless you get a vest that is embroidered in pure silk, people are gonna know that you got that at the store. The second important point is the accessories, okay? The details. If you cannot afford the dress and you can't do the dress, but you can do a cheaper version, or if you're a man, if all you have is cotton pants and a long sleeve shirt, it's the details. That's where you should start. The shoe, like for example, the shoes. Yes, these are historically reproduced. Now, you heard Jennifer say hers are from Amazon right now. All you have to do is look and see what style was at the time of your club, and then you can add the accessories yourself until you can get to the point where you can buy these. You don't have to go from 0 to 60 and get all of this stuff. So back to our player, I told him, I said, First of all, you wouldn't be playing in an embroidered silk vest. But when spectators are looking at you, or people in the crowd are looking at you, they notice the little details. You go to Disney World, what are they looking at? They want to make sure that Princess Jasmine has those earrings. I don't care what outfit she's wearing, but that jewelry was amazing, right? You're looking at the details. And that's what will give you away. So, you can start to make things yourself. You can find it on Etsy and get stuff made. But that's the thing, is the details. Major takeaways from this is the material. What's important was the details. Now, how do you still convince people, right? How do you still say, hey, you're going to come to the game. I want you to come to the game. You know, I want you to start participating. Or our club needs sideline interpreters. There are so many resources. We have so many resources. All of this stuff of what they had is online. If you're lucky, you can find one. I have an old catalog, and it's actually like three inches thick. It was a catalog, but it's a hardcover book, and it covered 2 years of what was in style, what were the colors, the whole thing, which is great. But we have the resources now to basically like fake it till you make it. But the important part is what you're using. For another example, bonnets, hats. Does this look like a hat from 1860s? It's not. It's from the thrift store. But what I did was I manipulated it to look like that hat. I took off a couple of these rows. You can actually take rows off of these. The ribbon, it's cotton, grosgrain ribbon. It's tied in the back. It has the little bow and everything. The accessories were in the back of your hat. So it looks fine. Did I go to the dollar store and get ribbon made from all new material? No. But I went to Joann and I got cotton grosgrain ribbon, which is super cheap. That's what we're using here. And you can see we've got, it's exactly the same kind of ribbon that we could get now. Even the jewelry, super, super simple. As far as men go, okay, so like with women, with jewelry, she said the drop earrings. So simple to go to Joann, buy the little hooks, buy two teardrop-shaped pendants, hook them on, boom, you got your drop earrings. For the men, I don't have a pocket watch. I don't have this, I don't have that. What you do, and I've done this for guys just to get through like an event, you get a chain. Again, you can go to the thrift store, buy a necklace, cut the stuff off of it, you've got a chain. Tuck one end in a pocket of your vest, and then you can either sew or hide how you've attached it on the other side if you don't have a clasp, and it looks like you've got your pocket watch in your pocket. Okay, anyone can do that. That's a $2 accessory, but you look the part. The other most important thing is none of us lived at that time. None of us were there. So the price deters people, the look deters people, like I can't do that, but the attitude also deters people. If someone comes up to you, like the guy from my club, if he came up to me in his vest, if he had found a polyester, because that's what it would have been if he had found this vest at the thrift store, he would have said, look at me, you know, I found my vest. And if I said, no, you are not coming on this field in a polyester embroidered vest, he's now done. He's done with baseball, he's done with history, he's done. But he tried. And what I did was, I said, it's good you didn't find it. It would have been cool, it's pretty. But people could tell that it wasn't appropriate for you. You know, like there's nice ways to say that and to help your people. But if they're going to come and they're going to do their best the first time, let them and then educate them. That's why nobody is coming to watch our games. Nobody is dressing up. Because they think they can't. They know what they're not going to do. And there's someone who's going to tell them they're doing a bad job. So don't do it. Tell them, yes, you can do this. No, you don't have to look like that. And do your best, and we'll go from there.
So if you're a club manager and you need sideline interpreters, they're just as much a part of your club as the players. It's a very important job because even if you're the club coach, you cannot work the crowd. You have to have a designated person working the crowd, and they have to look, they don't have to. They can work the crowd and tell your history and everything, even if they're in their jeans that day, that's fine. But if they're gonna do it, work with them. That's the problem. That's why people aren't doing this. Accessories. Again, keep it simple. If you wanna show up and sit down with a plate to have your basket of fruit, let's say you brought a snack to the game. I used to eat at the games. I would bring my basket and I would have some fruit and cheese. I got all my dishes at the thrift store too. Again, keep it simple. Handmade clay, handmade pottery. You can usually find plates or platters that have no mark on the bottom. If there's no mark, you can't date it. And it's going to look old. So whether it's from 1930 or not, if it's plain and just a plain, flat plate with no markings, it's better than nothing. And it looks good. And the crowd thinks it's good. So again, keep it simple, keep it natural. Plain china, pottery. You see us with our tin cups. Bring a tin cup, bring something. So again, keep it simple. Now, it took me like 10 years to get to the point of this, okay? And the whole time, I taught myself how to sew, I taught myself how to make these. I've made all my own accessories, I've made all my own hair things. It's fun, oh, it's fun. But there's also us out there that can do this. So Jennifer brought your resources. You know, like through the BBBA, you know that there's stitches. She's our seamstress. She can help. Even if you say, hey, I want pants and an official cotton shirt that a man would wear, go to our resources. If you're going on your own, especially as a man, they didn't have polo shirts. So when you go to a thrift store, they don't even have like a, you're not gonna go onto the field with a button-up shirt. So go to the thrift store, look for a long sleeve shirt, pullover with no collar, no buttons, take it home, cut the elastic off the waist, or off the wrists. If you can, tuck it under and sew it so you have just a cuff. Simple. So there's no reason, there's no actual reason why you cannot get people involved in sideline interpreting and looking the part. There's no reason they can't do this except people telling them they're not doing it right. And that's not cool. So, if I was gonna put a sheet out for you guys to put like your email, if you wanted to get, I could give a whole transcript of the presentation and what you should do and what you could do, that whole thing. But I was talking with Gary and I think I'm just gonna put it on the, I'll put my email address and something. If anyone's interested, if your club says, yes, we want this, we want, how do we help our people? Contact me, I will tell you. It's perfectly fine. I help a lot of clubs get started. And their first question is, well, what about uniforms? Not a problem, we can do it. Well, what did it look like? Again, if you don't have access to Godey's or anything online, but you know that your town is from 1860s, and like this town, you know that it was founded by German immigrants, what were your German people wearing? You can incorporate those accessories into your wear. If you're a German immigrant farmer, you're gonna be wearing that when you go play baseball at your neighbor's cornfield. So you don't have to have a Godey's look. You don't have to have the man's suit of the day. Keep it simple, go to your roots. Drop, sorry.
She gets passionate, you have to calm her down.
I do, I get really excited, I'm sorry.
Hey, Frank, so, if it was in her.
Let me see. We did the dishes, we did the accessories. But that's the thing. No all new material. Just keep it cotton. It's very simple. Every petticoat, even my first women's baseball dress that I played in, I fashioned it from stuff from a thrift store. And I'm not going to lie, I had people from museums say, wow, how did you get a historically accurate women's dress to play baseball in? And I looked at pictures. Yes?
I was just going to say that my boob skirt was from my sister who got married in the early 1990s when, they had bigger, that was kind of the style. And then I made my own petticoat. I don't have it on right now, but I have people at the park that have made them out of old sheets.
Mm-hmm. You know what I even did once when I had my women's team? We needed bases. I couldn't afford bases for my throw-together women's team. One of the women on the team, she had an old quilt. I made my bases out of the quilt because guess what? If there was a women's club, do you think anyone's going to sell them bases? No! You're going to hopefully have a blanket or something laying around that you could get the book that told you what the specs were, which is what I did. So they're made to spec, but they're made out of an old quilt. And I still have them. Like, it doesn't have to be perfect, it has to be real. What would people have been doing? Bob's speech was fun, because his stories were the real side, the rituals of baseball. It wasn't the rules. You know the rules, we all read the books. Let it go. You know the rules. What did the people actually do? How did they act? How did they look? When your spectators come, they don't care the entire history of your town, of your club or everything. They want the specific, it's like you have to think of like Disney World. They want the cool stuff. They want hit and miss on the cool stuff, and wow, those are really cool shoes. How did you do those earrings? That's what they want. Because when you pull them in with the cool stuff, then they're gonna go home and research your town and your club and go, oh my gosh, I had no idea that this town was German. I'm German, that's so cool. Now I wanna play for the German club. You know, that's what they do. You have to bring them in with something. That's your hook. Right? You gotta have a hook. I love marketing. I'm huge into marketing too. So that's your hook. You have to have a hook for the people. And then it not only helps bring people to your game, it gets your own team involved. You got people coming to the game now. You got people who want to play the game because they came and saw it. And then you got people showing up like, look at me. It's fun. When I did the dress look before this, I would have people come up to me. They would literally bring like accessories to a game. I don't know these people. And they'd say, look, Scrappy, look what I grew up. I got my grandmother's whatever. Well, yeah, grandma was from 1920, not 1860. But they started thinking of history. They started thinking. They went home and they said, what could I do to have like that? Like her. Wow, that's great. And then they look at what I've done. And how did you do that? It's really, really easy. Google it. Google was my grandmother that taught me how to sew. I am not lying. And now I make dresses. I make everything. It's not that hard, but it's not necessary. So don't tell your people, if you're going to come and spectate, you have to be a woman in your dress. Well, guess what? If I'm an immigrant German woman farmer, I might not have a day dress either. I might be walking around in God knows what. You don't know. Were you there? What did this woman get off the boat with? I don't know, but she wants to come and watch the baseball game in town. So put on a pair of cotton pants and a cotton shirt, put your hair up. Okay, maybe you're a dude with long hair now. It doesn't matter. You're there in a costume that people are gonna look at and go, oh. Okay, and then what you do is say, listen, this is probably not what a woman was gonna wear at the time, but this is what I have, and I'm portraying this look. And it's okay to explain yourself as well. That's another problem that a lot of people use to deter people getting involved. able to explain what you have. If you're not doing it right, just explain it. Just say, hey, I didn't have the dress, but this is what I have. And as long as you do that, the vintage police are gonna stay away. That's all you gotta do. And we know what there was, but we have to do what we can to get there. And that's what's important. So it's not all for women, it's for any spectator. So if you have, yeah, if you have further questions, if your own club needs help and you're like, how do I do that? Hit me up on the BBBA Town Hall page, email me if you know me, not a problem. So Jennifer's got her cards here. I have cards, and you all, like I said, you all have access to Stitches through the BBBA. And then if you are someone who's like, you know what, I want to go from 0 to 60, I also put out a seamstress card here. Her name's Glenda. She's my friend, and she does the historical costuming for like the fancy stuff. So go for gold. But yeah, come up here, look at this, and you're gonna see how really simple it is. This is just, it's just ribbon. So I don't know, I'm assuming from the applause next door, probably out of time. You guys have any questions? Excellent.
I also have that block for the men.
Right, we